Wow, that's interesting. It takes me back. Actually, it began before I began my formal schooling. My mom was a teacher long time ago in a place called Nyeri. And I remember the first instance where I drew something and there was appreciation for it was when she took me to one of her classrooms, because I was too young to be in class, and she gave me a piece of paper and some crayons, and I drew a yellow Porsche on the paper. And once I'd finished, I realized that the kids in the classroom had all come to see what I was doing, and they were so fascinated by it, not because it was the greatest drawing in the world, but to me it showed me that I can create something and somebody else would actually appreciate it. That was my first memory of my art. This later translated into me choosing my career as a designer, graphic designer, which I turned into quite a successful business. Then in the 90s, 1991, I had a solo exhibition where I exhibited watercolor paintings at Trade Bank Center, now defunct. But it was a very successful exhibition actually, because I sold all my paintings, and under the guidance of my dad, actually, who was an artist, he's the one who showed me how to paint trees actually. I was quite inspired to continue my art, but life happens and my career took over, and I kept saying, I'll do some artwork someday. Well, a couple of years later, I think it was 2013, I picked up the paint and brushes and did something for myself. And I kept many of these paintings for myself. And it's only in 2019 that I made a conscious decision to get back into fine art for myself, because it's a question of accountability. If I'm doing design, I'm accountable to my client. If I'm doing art, I'm accountable to myself. And I think now is the time for me to be able to share my ideas and whatever I've been keeping inside, in my head, in my imagination, and extend it onto paper and have people look at it, and perhaps it will add value. Yes, it's possible to make money as a fine artist in Kenya as long as you've got a plan. And the plan, this is not a prescription for doing business as an artist in Kenya. I'm not trying to follow anybody's path or ask anybody to follow into my path. It's just that for me, I think it needs to be looked at as a business, because it takes time. Anything that takes time and you have to make a living and you're not living isolated from everybody else, death and taxes we have, you gotta tie the two together and be serious about it. That being said, you can do art as a hobby where you do the doodles or paintings or sculptures and put them away. If you get that intrinsic value for yourself, that is perfectly in order. But it is actually possible to make a living out of art. It's just that you've got to have a plan.
After the invisible, what topics are you thinking about?
I have, through my travels, a large portion has been spent in the Horn of Africa. I've met wonderful people from the Horn of Africa, and I've had a sample of their culture, which is far removed from what we normally see in the media or perceive it to be. So next year there'll be a series of paintings and sculptures from the north, from my inspiration about people in the Horn of Africa. And it will be totally different from what you've seen prior.
Any hint?
Somalia comes to mind. I'll leave it at that. I don't think society values artists in this particular region at all. I might add, artists are probably the only people who, without an army behind them, without weapons of mass destruction behind them, can actually cause a war. If you think about Adolf Hitler was a failed artist. And when he was told that he has failed and he cannot get into the place that he wanted to be as an artist, he became who he was. When you think about Charlie Hebdo, the attacks that took place, I may not agree with the way, the approach that they took, but that's the power of an artist. In our society, Kenya, for example, you have artists who've rendered politicians or governments in a particular light, and that has caused certain movements to come up, and it has led to downfall of certain people. So art is very powerful, but artists are not really valued. That's why somebody would say, like, hey Joe, you paint really well, can you draw a picture of me? Then I say, yes I can, but I'll need X number of dollars to do that. Like, why? But you're an artist, you can do it. It's like, well, you don't go to Michael Jackson and tell Michael Jackson, hey, Michael Jackson, you can sing. Can you sing for me? And I don't pay you anything. And he goes and writes a song and performs it for you, and then nothing? No, we're not, this is not a circus. And that ties into the aspect of art as a business. Artists also need to take themselves seriously. That's why I have a commissions page on my website. Commissions means that you may like my style or my variety of styles, but you don't see anything that can actually fit within your abode, whether it's an office, home, etc. And you want something bespoke. Perhaps you have a memory, you have a feeling, you have a certain portrait that you want done for yourself or your family. You come to me and say, like, Joe, I'd like you to paint ABCD. I'll tell you, yes, I can do that. It's going to cost you ABCD and it's going to take this long. So we get into a contract and I render it for you, and it's only for you. I will not show it anywhere else. In fact, that's been happening quite a bit in the past. So artists have to take themselves seriously as well. On the other hand, you've got this kind of art brokers. They are not art dealers. They are not facilitators. They are basically, I'll call them con artists in the broadest sense of the word, because they claim to represent artists, and I'm not painting every, they know who they are. I've come across some of them. They claim to represent artists and their art, but what they do is just take advantage. But I guess that's normal in any industry. I think it's important for artists to use oratory skills to speak about their work, because it's an additional form of expression and it adds value. It's not paint-splaining every single painting. It's just that sometimes a deeper meaning might need to be, how shall I say, emphasized. So at the end, when somebody purchases a painting and hangs it on their wall, they will not have a tag at the bottom saying exactly what the painting is, not even a title. But for the person who is immersed in that painting as a collector or as an art buyer, will remember what the artist said about it. So it's important, yes, to have those oratory skills attached to their artwork. Well, I've heard something similar. I've heard that you cannot create unless you're in a certain state of depression, or if you're euphoric, you cannot be able to create a piece. But I think that's as diverse as human beings are. There are some artists who, only when they're in a gloomy and a melancholy mood, that's when they paint something. Some, when they go through a traumatic experience, is when they express themselves like that and put it in paper or sculpture form. But for me, what I look at is holistic kind of experiences. For example, if I take a trip, when I took a trip to the Mara, and I took photographs of animals, and I immersed myself in those photographs. And it took about 2 years for me to actually set up my wildlife series, of which I drew my experience from. So it's not always trauma. It's not always, there has to be something disastrous that's happened. Yeah, it's about experience. If your experience is trauma and you paint it, well and good, fine, project yourself that way. But as for me, I look at it in a slightly different form. I'd like people to have a look at my art. However simple the drawings, paintings, and renderings seem to be, just know that there's a deeper meaning behind them. And if you go onto my website, you'll be able to have quite a variety of styles, topics, and themes. In there, you'll probably see something that relates to your situation. And if it's an eye-opener, give a comment, give a review. I'd love to hear from you.